Thank you, Mr. Speaker, sir, the Honourable Prime Minister, Leader of the Opposition, Honourable Ministers and Honourable Members of Parliament. Mr. Speaker, sir, I rise today in this Honourable House to lend my full support to the 2020-2021 National Budget. At the outset, I personally wish to congratulate the Honourable Attorney General and Minister for Economy and his team for presenting to this August House and to the nation a bold and timely budget. Mr. Speaker, sir, as most countries across the globe slowly move into recovery phase, respective governments are not only being tested on how effectively they can address COVID-19, but more importantly on how resilient they are in this recovery phase. As such, Mr. Speaker, sir, for me, put very simply, this budget for 2021 is all about changing adversity into opportunities. I say it again, the 2020-21 national budget, put very simply, is about changing adversities into opportunities. And Honourable Speaker, sir, for that, it needs courage in the face of adversaries. Unfortunately, the Honourable Rousseff is not here. We need courage, not rhetoric, during these difficult times, Mr. Speaker, sir. It requires bold, visionary, strategic leadership as opposed to the weak, irresponsible, rudderless and deceptive leadership on the other side of the House. Mr. Speaker, sir, I've said this so often in this House, during periods as such, we have to control our circle of influence, Mr. Speaker, sir. Let's not be overwhelmed by our circle of concerns. This is the time to put on the Telebu mantra, push Telebu. No problem, no bus fare, pay that. That's it, Mr. Speaker, sir. So we need that bold, visionary, strategic leadership to take us through this difficult period. Mr. Speaker, sir, let's look within. Let's look within. Let's believe in ourselves. Let's look in our abilities, our own abilities, in our own potentials. Let's believe in our own people. Let's be patriotic about Fiji. That's what this whole 2020-21 budget is about. It's about changing adversities into opportunities, Mr. Speaker, sir. Mr. Speaker, sir, the 2020-21 budget before the House provides Fiji the much needed stimulant to support the recovery of our economy and, most importantly, rebuild the livelihoods of all Fijians affected by calamities, namely COVID-19 and TC Herald. Mr. Speaker, sir, yet again, the other side of the House has continued to politicize the sufferings of ordinary Fijians that have been affected and that will be supported in the budget before the House. We are talking about the situation that we are going through. They are already looking into 2022, because for them it's all about elections. It's not about the issues that we have. They did this when we assisted Fijians during the COVID-19 supplementary budget, Mr. Speaker, sir, and yet again have continued to echo the same rhetoric now and remain intentionally blind to the realities of today. Mr. Speaker, sir, this government has yet again put Fiji first in our 2020-2021 national budget. In our efforts to boldly recover and rebuild better in this somewhat new normal world, to reiterate the Honourable Prime Minister, this budget gives help where it's needed most. Mr. Speaker, sir, there's a lot of noise from the opposition on government debt. When we think of it, Mr. Speaker, Fiji is not the only country borrowing now, especially the cushion, the impact of COVID-19, and certainly we are not the only country with a high debt level. Let me just add a few lines to what the Honourable Minister of Agriculture has talked about on the Honourable Dr. Biman's, Professor Biman's Prasad, about his analysis of the budget. But before that, Mr. Speaker, sir, let me just clarify an issue raised by the Honourable Leonora Gilgerrit-Tambua. As Minister responsible, if the tin fish that was part of the assistance package that was offered to the people of Kandavu is of inferior quality, we do convey our sincere apology to the recipients. However, let me state, Mr. Speaker, sir, that here in with me is the health certificate that brought that product into Fiji, Mr. Speaker, sir. What she was referring to is canned mackerel in tomato sauce or canned mackerel in vegetable oil? Mr. Speaker, sir, Motubai is the agent, and we are governed by government's procurement policies. And this contract is given to Motubai. And the above-mentioned goods are in conformity with the sanitary requirements and fit for human consumption. But she was referring to what was banned in Malaysia. Mr. Speaker, sir, according to what we have found out, what was banned in Malaysia was sardines. There is a difference between sardines and canned mackerel in vegetable oil or canned mackerel in tomato sauce. I need to clarify that, because if it's sardines, unfortunately the can is not here. Bring the can after this. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, sir. That needs to be clarified, because what was banned was sardines and not mackerel in oil or in tomato sauce. Mr. Speaker, sir, again, national debt is an accumulation of debt across many years of different governments. In fact, there has been a very few instances of government having a surplus budget. All governments have basically rolled over previous debts or loans. The truth is that the Bainimarama government has been clearing up the mess of previous politicians who were focused on short-term gains instead of the interests of the Fijian people. Mr. Speaker, the Bainimarama-led government has been paying off the loans taken by the Alliance government, NFP and Fiji Labour Party government, the SPT government and SDL government, not to mention the excessive interest rates charged on these loans. When the Bainimarama government took over, we inherited about 2.5 billion of the previous government's debts. Since then, the Bainimarama government has paid over 2 billion just in interest on the debt it inherited, and every year some of this inherited debt matures. The Bainimarama government repays this debt by taking new debt. This is called rolling over debt. This is not something unique to Fiji, but practiced by other countries, including US, the UK and Australia. Debt and interest payments are due every week. Order. For Fiji, there order. Is a lunch bond due in the next financial year, in October, order. Mr. Speaker, sir. This debt was initially taken by SDL in 2006, which the Bainimarama government has rolled over twice. Mr. Speaker, to put things into better perspective, we can attribute almost 500 million in debt repayments to loan decisions by the former SDL government. We can now all see that the Honorable Prasad is twisting data to suit his own opinion. He should not misguide the Fijian people. Mr. Speaker, sir, he should be truthful and say that half of the debt we are repaying today was a result of the loan taken by SDL. But he will not say that. After all, to do so, he would be to put the Sodelpa Party or Honorable Rambukan down. If we were to exclude the debt by former SDL government, the debt serving is more like 50 million. In fact, Mr. Speaker, sir, I will take this opportunity to perhaps educate the other side of the House and our colleagues on the far side of the aisle on good economics. Firstly, he should know that it is not about the absolute amount but percentage of debt to GDP. And that is the appropriate measure, Honorable Professor. USA, Japan, Italy and Singapore, all developed countries and economic powerhouses, have a debt to GDP ratio of over 100%. Each Fiji's debt, through increasing because of COVID-19, is far safer. Secondly, Mr. Speaker, sir, a significant amount of Fiji's debt has been inherited from previous governments, including the SDL, also Delpa, which is due in October. But let me say this, Mr. Speaker, sir, the Honorable Prasad fails to acknowledge that $430 million of debt serving, which has already been saved and is sitting in government sinking fund, so money is already saved in the current financial year, but will be paid in the new financial year. I think I've heard enough of that, Mr. Speaker, sir. Well, a first-year student can teach a professor. Mr. Speaker, sir, let me relate debt to infrastructure. And let me refer to the Honorable Nikon Waikula, or the Honorable Jonah. He was correct, Mr. Speaker, sir. It was the Ratumara government that was more into investment. And this government, unfortunately, that's where he needs to be corrected, is more into consumption. But let me say this, Mr. Speaker, sir. The Honorable Pio Chikundundua will agree to this. When we started off with FRA in 2013, if I remember the year correctly, in one of the first briefings that was given to the Honorable Prime Minister and the Minister and the senior government officials, they talked about the poor state of infrastructure in Fiji that we inherited. Mr. Speaker, sir, bridges, I'll just touch on bridges. We have about 609 bridges back then. I think it's more than 1,000 now. Out of the figure that they gave, Mr. Speaker, sir, of 609, 75 of those bridges were classified as critical. And 120 more were classified as urgent. Why was this, Mr. Speaker, sir? For two obvious reasons. One is the overloading, but the other one was the lack of maintenance and the lack of investment into this infrastructure by governments previously. Mr. Speaker, sir, the lifetime of a bridge is supposed to be 85 years. But unfortunately, bridges in Fiji, the average is only about 43 years. And simply because of poor and lack of maintenance previously. That is what this government inherited. And we have discussed this so many times in this Honorable House, Mr. Speaker, sir. This government, again, is investing in our infrastructure. And that is linked to our borrowing and, of course, to our debts as well. But when we are financing this infrastructure, definitely governments that will come later, Honorable Speaker, sir, will not have to do another highway from Buatundraketi. Mr. Speaker, sir, let me just touch on bridges again. I ask the Honorable Leader of the Opposition and the Honorable Noe Kula and the Honorable Bulitabu, when they are next in Wonolebu, one, we have just fixed the Watundoba Bridge. Secondly, you go to Korobuli now, government is fixing the Korobuli Bridge. Past Korobuli, you come to Vesinrua, government is fixing that bridge now. This is amongst the 75 and the 120 that I was referring to, Mr. Speaker, sir. You go past Vesinrua, before the junction to Sabu Sabu, that bridge, I don't know the name, that's currently under construction now, Mr. Speaker, sir. You go down to the Konrobe, before Boys Town, Walanga Bay, that bridge before Boys Town, Mr. Speaker, sir, that bridge is under construction now. Because of the critical stage they were in, or urgent, because of lack of maintenance from previous years, but thankful to the Fiji First government, we are investing in our infrastructure for the good and the betterment of our Fijians tomorrow, Mr. Speaker, sir. So there will there's no need for them to take more debts to build these bridges. And of course, the roads. I will not go into the roads and the water and the jetties. Honorable Chale, we have fixed the jetty in Moala, but of course, that jetty has done its time. It has to be taken away. It's all there in the government's plan. And we will look into that, Mr. Speaker, sir. This is the problem, Mr. Speaker, sir. I have mentioned this in previous budgets. Now, we add RERE to the strategic paralysis, Mr. Speaker, sir, and that's why they are confused. Government and private sector spending, Mr. Speaker, sir, government spending is critical for our domestic economy. Government is spending alone in nearly 20% of our total GDP. What I want to say, Mr. Speaker, sir, is the rest of our domestic spending is from the private sector, but with high liquidity in the domestic market and the various initiatives in this budget, it is anticipated, and we hope, that the private sector will seize the opportunities, because this budget is about changing our adversities into opportunities. Micro and small and medium enterprises, Mr. Speaker, sir, what saddens me is when we talk about assistances by government, previously, we always talk about freebies. Freebies, freebies. That includes a $1,000 grant. But Mr. Speaker, sir, if we look at the budget, while government has scaled down a number of programs in the 2020-21 budget, it will continue with the existing initiatives in introduce new measures to support the unemployed through MSMEs and the tourism sector. And hopefully, Mr. Speaker, sir, these $1 grants, they would have grown, the threshold, business threshold, would have improved, Mr. Speaker, sir. And of course, if I remember correctly, 7,000 is the minimum for them to achieve, acquire a loan because of the turnover. So it's very positive, Mr. Speaker, sir. It's not freebies, but it's about a leg up so that people, during these difficult times, if these MSEs are doing well, this is when they will grow and they will provide the much needed employment in the various sectors, particularly in rural Fiji. Mr. Speaker, sir, let me touch on rural development. We have an allocation of 16.6 million in the new financial year, and the specifics will be covered by Honorable Singarara, and of course the Honorable Vijay Nath has talked briefly about disaster management. But Mr. Speaker, sir, government is not only supporting MSMEs, but we are also investing heavily into our rural and maritime programs across all sectors. I say that again, across all sectors. In the 2020-2021 financial year, government plans to invest a total of 144 million in the rural and maritime sector. Oh, the Honorable Sokuru is not here. He needs to hear this. 144 million across all sectors. 5 million in the Ministry of Rural and Maritime Development and Disaster Management. 18 million in the Ministry of Agriculture. 79 million with the Ministry of Infrastructure. 3.6 million with the Ministry of Fisheries. 4.1 million with the Ministry of Forests. 1.8 million with the Ministry of Lands and Mineral Resources. And 9 million with the Ministry of Health and Medical Services. Mr. Speaker, sir, we have always said this. This government, we ensure that no one is left behind. There is so much potential in rural Fiji, but we need to create the environment. And unfortunately, I've said this already in this house, prior to the elections in 2014 and again in 2018, opposition keeps telling the people of Fiji, do not be fooled by the amount of developments going on in Fiji, because that's the responsibility of every government. Yes, because we are doing it so well, Mr. Speaker. Yes, yet they are asking, where is the money? Talking about freebies, we have done a lot for rural Fijian communities, and we will continue to do that, Mr. Speaker, sir. Mr. Speaker, as I have previously echoed in this August House, national security is vital for economic security and development. And this brings me to the mandate provided to me as Minister for Defence, National Security and Policing. Again, I just need to acknowledge the RFMF and the Fiji Police Force, Mr. Speaker, sir. And for the Fiji Police Force, we welcome this increase in the Fiji Police Force. I've toured the stations, Mr. Speaker, sir, and going back to the infrastructure. Unfortunately, Mr. Speaker, sir, the police station in Lembasa, all the police stations all over Fiji were built from Ratumara's days. But we talk about police brutality. Look at the environment that they are working in. Fiji has grown over the years, Mr. Speaker, sir. Rural-urban rift is a global phenomenon. And not only that, development comes with its price, but we need to create the environment for our police officers. I will not go into the details. And that is why, for the new police stations, they are not actually new, so to speak, Mr. Speaker, sir, because these are rollover from last year. We have started, if you go to Lautoka now, it's almost halfway, Mr. Speaker, sir. You go to Nandi should be ready, if things go according to plan, by December this year. Or otherwise, the latest, this is according to, and if we get the supplies, February next year, the new Nandi police station, that will be a state-of-the-art police station, Mr. Speaker, sir. So we are thankful. We are thankful to the contribution. The RFMF during COVID-19, the RFMF acts very well as the strategic reserve for the Fijian government, Mr. Speaker, sir. And I thank them for the allocation and, of course, given to the military as well. Sorry, the naval division. And I wish to also thank government for giving us funding, particularly for our fight against drugs in Kandavu alone, Mr. Speaker, sir, not targeting Kandavu, but with the use of two drones to Kandavu, we confiscated about $89 million worth of marijuana just by the use of two drones, Mr. Speaker, sir. This is why the allocation given to the Fiji Police Force is justified, and the need for the new police stations not only will see money circulating in the construction industry, but it will also create employment and, most importantly, create the environment for our police officers so that they can excel in the work that, that they do, Mr. Speaker, sir. Let me conclude. Mr. Speaker, this pandemic has taught us a valuable lesson in recognizing that non-traditional threats have the capacity to maim the global economy, which in turn affects the security paradigm. I still don't see Honorable Sekuru there. I wanted to just remind him, Mr. Speaker, sir, that he has quoted from 2 Chronicles 7:14. I suggest that he just goes back one verse before that. 13, when I shut up the heaven and there is no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people, and then verse 14 comes on. But Mr. Speaker, sir, is it an act of God? I do believe that God allows this pandemic so that we can draw closer to him, Mr. Speaker, sir. Irrespective of how the opposition has labeled the budget before the House, it does not take away the fact that this is a well-thought-out budget, a budget that is for the people and boldly designed to change the adversity of this pandemic into opportunities for the greater prosperity of all Fijians. Honourable Speaker, with this, I close by reiterating my full support for the 2020-2021 national budget.